Ahora vamos a hablar con nuestro compañero, Luis Meiner, directamente desde Nueva York. Hola, Luis.
Ah, Alejandro.
Estamos ante una verdadera rebelión. ¿Qué alcance tienen las acciones y cómo interpreta su significado? ¿Cómo se vinculan con el contexto más general de la situación política y económica de Estados Unidos y la desastrosa respuesta del gobierno a la pandemia?
Okay, so the first thing that must be said is the reach that this rebellion has. To begin with, it started a week ago in Minneapolis. It started after the murder of George Floyd, but now it has grown into a national anti-racist movement that has done actions in more than 140 cities across the United States. Different types of actions, protests, marches, demonstrations have been registered all around the country, in of course in the larger cities, but also in smaller towns and even in rural areas. So we have to say that to begin with, there is a national scope of the struggle. And I think it's very correct to classify it as a rebellion. What we are seeing is much more than protests. We are seeing a grassroots rebellion, a massive rebellion that involves hundreds of thousands of people around the U.S. With a huge participation of African American and multiracial composition of very young people, mostly that have taken to the streets in different cities across the country. So the first thing would be to speak about this, this extension of the movement and its meaning, and also to define it as a real rebellion. This, of course, has probably opened a new moment in class struggle in the United States. This is a new moment in class struggle. And once again, it has shown the importance of the Black liberation movement as the vanguard of the entire working class in the United States. There is a continuity between the struggles that started during the pandemic and this new situation. We have seen, for example, during the pandemic, hundreds of wildcat strikes throughout the U.S., strikes in Amazon, strikes in grocery stores, strikes in the nurses by the nurses union. So there is a connection between that wildcat wave of strikes and what is going on right now. We have to say that, for example, many of the people that are on the streets are probably essential workers. So there is a clear link between one thing and the other. So there is a continuity of the struggles that started during the pandemic and that are now continuing. Of course, there is the rage that we are seeing is largely due to the disastrous response that the U.S. government, that Trump has had for the pandemic. It must be said that there are more than 100,000 dead in the United States. And the pandemic exposed the huge inequalities of the capitalist system in the United States, the huge racial and class inequalities. It exposed how African-American and working class communities, Latinx communities are the ones that have the worst access to healthcare, that are the most exposed to the virus, that have the worst living conditions, the highest risk jobs. So these inequalities are at the heart, the rage against these inequalities is at the heart of the rebellion that we are seeing. So there is definitely a link between the more general context and what we are watching right now. There has been a deepening of these inequalities that was produced by the pandemic in itself, and therefore what we are seeing is also a response to the disastrous mismanagement of the pandemic by the Trump administration.
En Estados Unidos vienen produciéndose cambios muy grandes en la lucha de clases y también en la conciencia. Este es un nuevo salto. ¿Estamos en una nueva etapa en Estados Unidos, en el mundo? ¿Cómo ves esto?
Okay, so over the past 10 years, we have seen changes in the level of consciousness and in class struggle in the United States. We have to trace this back to the 2008-2009 crisis. Out of which came movements such as Occupy, and also Black Lives Matter. And these movements had a huge impact in the level of consciousness and also in class struggle in general. So definitely the 2008-2009 crisis meant a change, a deep change. And we are still seeing many of the consequences of that change. And now we have entered probably a new moment and a new stage in which these changes have taken a much deeper dimension. We have to mention that over the past decade, there has been a left turn in the level of consciousness. There are thousands and probably millions of young people that consider themselves socialists. We have many polls that show that there is, for example, massive support for Medicare for all. There's massive support for structural change within the functioning of U.S. capitalism. And that is, of course, very positive. And it shows that there's a new moment in the level of consciousness. This situation now is probably taking that even a step further. It is opening a new moment in class struggle. We will have to continue debating and analyzing this, but there are hundreds of thousands of people participating, and we can see that this will probably change how they behave in their workplaces, how they organize in their workplaces, how this impacts in campuses and all around U.S. society. So this is really a very important structural change, and we will have to continue analyzing. Of course, this has also a huge impact on the more general political situation. We've seen that there has been a terribly repressive response by the state. There are hundreds of people arrested. There is police violence in the streets. There are terrible images of police cars running over people, images of huge repression. And this response of the state has also made the protests intensify and grow. So regardless of what happens in the near future, this has been a massive change. And one of the things that must be noted is that the cities that are mostly hit by state repression, many of them or most of them are governed by Democratic mayors and Democratic governors, state governors. So it's the Democratic Party that has called in the National Guard, and of course we have also seen the same response from the Trump administration, adding more trouble to the situation, saying that when the looting starts, the shooting starts. That's what Trump said in Twitter. So it's obvious that the response from Trump is a very repressive response. But we have seen the same response from the Democratic governments. So this is the response from the state, from both parties of U.S. capitalism. And we must say that this has also a huge impact in the world situation. We've seen that there have been protests going on all over the world, in London, in France, in Canada, in New Zealand, in Brazil, all over the world. With the world, we've seen protests that have been inspired by what's going on in the United States. I know that in Argentina there will be, there have been also protests. So I think this is a very important moment, and this definitely is changing the world situation.
La izquierda, ¿qué dice y qué hace frente a esto? Me estoy refiriendo tanto a los reformistas como a los revolucionarios. ¿Cuáles son para vos las tareas que están planteadas?
Okay, so one aspect, of course, for us, they're not part of the left, but this has been very revealing for millions of the role that the Democrats play, and it has revealed for millions that the Democrats are part of the repressive capitalist state. It's very significant that it's been very liberal and supposedly left-leaning Democrats that have been the ones that are calling in the National Guard, such as the mayor of Minneapolis or the mayor of Atlanta. So we have these supposedly liberal progressive Democrats calling in the National Guard. So I think that's been very significant, and millions of people are seeing this. This has really shown the true face of the Democratic Party. It has unmasked those so-called progressive liberals. So added to this, we have seen also the role of what are supposedly the most progressive wing inside the Democrats, that are Bernie Sanders and different sectors. And we've seen that they have been really far behind the situation. I mean, they have not provided at all any sort of national leadership for the movement. They haven't been outspokenly supporting the movement. They have just basically expressed themselves through the social media, through Facebook, through Twitter, but they haven't been in solidarity with the protests at the level that they should have been. So it also proves that in a situation in which the class struggle becomes stronger, these reformist sectors within the Democratic Party show their true face and their true nature. And it must be said also that the DSA, which is the largest left-wing organization of the United States, it has about 60,000 members on a national scale, has also been very far behind the role it should play. We have not seen the DSA being an organic part of the protests. We don't see an organized DSA presence. Many members of the DSA, of course, go to the protests, but we haven't seen an organized DSA presence. There have been good statements made nationally by the DSA, and of course at several different local levels. But at this point, it's statements are not enough. We should see much more commitment of the DSA towards the organizing and being an organic part of this rebellion. So this also speaks to the limits of the DSA, that is very electorally oriented towards elections. And this means that it is not a party that is organized towards class struggle. And in these situations of crisis and rebellions, we can see that we can see those limitations actually in practice. And for one would think, what are the tasks of the left? I think to begin with, we have to stand together with the protests, and we have to say that we are defending this rebellion against the attacks of the state, and that we think that it is time to dismantle the racist police, to dismantle the racist state. So we have to be able to begin with, stand in solidarity, and also to provide our knowledge in organization. In the left can be a very important can play a very important role to organize, to coordinate, and to provide a national character, to deepen the national character of these struggles. For example, the DSA has 60,000 members. If we could see that 60,000 strong membership playing an active part in the protest, that would be very important. So I think that's we have to reorient towards class struggle quickly. And of course, I think that the left can play a role in the sense of explaining and establishing the links between racial oppression and capitalist exploitation, and the need to continue this struggle, not just against the police, the racist police, not just against the racist state, but also against racist capitalism. The struggle against capitalism and for socialism is very important, and we have to be able to say this massively in order to be able to build strong organizations with this radicalizing generation, with this radicalizing activism that we are seeing. So more than ever, it is very important to build a strong socialist working class organization and a socialist party that can be up to the needs of this growth and radicalization in class struggle.
Por último, Luis, ¿quisieras agregar algo para todos los compañeros y compañeras que te están viendo?
Well, to all comrades of the ISL and comrades in general that are listening, I think it's very important that we organize actions throughout the world in solidarity with this movement. This is a massive change that also shows that a new stage in class struggle is opening with the pandemic and the consequences of the pandemic. The uprising in the United States is absolutely a part of the more general context, and it would act to further deepen this dynamic of class struggle. So it will definitely open up a new moment in class struggle, and I think we have to be ready with our organizations and as socialist activists to step up to the situation, to organize, to build large organizations and revolutionary organizations to be able to face this new situation that we are living.
Muchas gracias, Luis. Vamos a seguir en contacto porque lo que está pasando en Estados Unidos es apasionante.